Hello. On behalf of the Centers for Integrative Medicine and Health at Trinity Health of New England, I want to welcome you to this week's installment of Wellness Wednesday. Wellness Wednesday is designed to bring, in brief format, tools for wellness that will benefit our colleagues and communities at large. The topic we're focusing on this week is called a delayed response. We've been thinking about the year that we've all gone through with COVID-19 and other events in our lives that can have such an impact on us. And sometimes we respond right away, and sometimes we respond a little bit later. And so we've been seeing, as we work with colleagues and patients, sort of a delayed response to what has been this past year and to other events. And so I'm here today with my colleague, Tim Michaels. And Tim, you've been mentioning this delayed response in what we've seen with our colleagues and in some other situations. Can you just kind of flesh this out a little bit for us?
Yeah, I would really love to. So the hard part around this topic today is going to be, we promise to keep these videos short. So I say that now almost at the beginning of every one, because these are really rich topics. So first thing I want to point out too is the notion of a delayed response for me could be positive and or negative. Mm-hmm. So a delayed response could be something as simple as you've hosted the most incredible family gathering and you've been running around all day and you had a good time, but it's delayed response in that moment is kind of known as savoring. Everybody's gone to bed, you finally sit down, kick your shoes off, and you start reliving all these wonderful moments that you couldn't stop to really be present to, but now they're all kind of flooding over you. So that's kind of a positive delayed response reaction. Mm-hmm. The other one is what I most often experience, let's say, when I have taken care of somebody who's had a long-term illness, and you're running on adrenaline for months on end, mm-hmm. And when the illness is over, however it ends, and all of a sudden you find yourself on a quiet day, you find yourself in the middle of a grocery store, it's a sunny day, there's no drama, nobody's calling you with an emergency, visiting nurses and calling, and you just find yourself angry at the people who are in your way, you find yourself crying for no good reason, and it feels delayed, or I like to call them out of context, mm-hmm. to the environment I'm in. And then you start thinking everybody else looks happy, why don't they know what's happening? And we do an external comparison that makes the delayed response harder in that we don't want to feel it in that moment. So we either stuff it away or convince ourselves there's something wrong.
Right,
and
right.
So now if I put it into the picture of the last year, we've all had this shared global experience of a pandemic. Then as a country, we had a shared experience around politics. And then in our communities, racial unrest or community unrest or what have you, right down to the nucleus in our own homes. And it's just that thing about multiple people in the same experience all having a different response. Some screamed right in the moment when it was happening, others all of a sudden 6 months later. So that's kind of what I'm thinking.
Similar to the way that we process grief, right? You power through initially, you get through the whole loss, and then you're kind of left with these images, with these memories, with these situations that can come back at the weirdest times. And
yeah.
Very unpredictable too, very unpredictable.
And they carry, you know, we hear words like people saying, no, I feel guilty.
Yes.
You know, everything is okay now. Or lately I've been hearing people in our healthcare setting saying, well, you know, I wasn't at the bedside, so I feel guilty, I'm this upset. And I appreciate where that's coming from because I felt that myself. Yet, there was an impact of the last year that was unique to me. And I may not have been able to acknowledge it in the moment, and it's popping up at different times right now. And I find that I'm either being distracted so I don't have to feel it, or I'm getting lost in it a little bit. So I've been kind of trying to find a way that I can kind of, like grieving, get to the point where I understand that I just have to live with this the way it is, mm-hmm. until it's not a thought in the front of my mind 24 hours a day.
Yeah, and I think too, the challenge with this delayed response is that everybody does it their own way. And we have to be both mindful of our own responses to this, and be patient with ourselves, but also if someone's just acting out of context, we've just had a really hard year. And so everybody's going to come through this recovery period a little bit differently, a little bit differently than everybody else. And so I think this is an interesting place where mindfulness comes into play, right? Just being able to recognize, wow, it's a gorgeous sunny day, just like you said, and I feel lousy and sad, and it just doesn't fit. And sitting with that and being okay with that and not judging ourselves, right? The judgment piece is always the hard part for mindfulness for me, the hard part.
Right. The judgment piece and the misconception that I look around and everybody looks like they're moving on and having a good day.
Right.
You know, so I remember in the course through Yale for the science of well-being, Dr. Santos warns about your external reference points. You know, you have to be really careful. If you want to become an athlete-like and you're putting in the training and you have the skill, then maybe that's a reasonable goal. But if you are feeling deeply the loss of something and you're comparing yourself to everybody else in the family who went through it or the community, and you're saying they moved on, why aren't I?
Yeah.
That comparison is really wrong because I don't think they have moved on. They've either shifted into a place of denial or not talking or what have you. But it doesn't mean they moved on.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, you said something funny about acceptance. I think that's one of the tricks of mindfulness, I think, is not fighting the current moment you're in.
Right. Yep. Feeling that sadness, feeling that anger, feeling whatever it is, feeling that notion of being out of place. And almost as a third party observer, isn't that interesting? I wonder why this is happening today at this moment. And just being curious about it takes a lot of the power out of it and allows us to have just sort of a different understanding of what's going on in our heads, you know, just a different understanding.
Can you go back and just kind of slow that down for me? I like to joke with people and say, I'm only a man. I have my pen. I got a shirt. But I've heard some other people say that before is try to become an observer of it. And I think sometimes when I'm caught in it, I automatically go to being a judge of the situation. So go it again slowly. What does being an observer sound like, look like, feel like?
So I think if we take pain for an example, right? So pain is a good example of the observership. So you have shoulder pain, and you know you have shoulder pain. And if we have shoulder pain and we think, oh God, here it comes again. Oh no, I'm not gonna be able to lift the groceries out of the car. Whatever it is, we kind of ramp ourselves up and we let the pain take control of us. And what's not easy to do, but interesting to do, is step back from ourselves and say, huh, isn't that interesting? I feel that in the front part of my shoulder today. I think yesterday it was in the back part. It's kind of throbby. Isn't that, like, that's really interesting. I wonder what I did to cause this. Let me just see what this feels like and pause and literally just take a look at it. What it does is we step back from pain or fear or sadness and look at it like someone else would, less judgmental than ourselves. And it takes the power out of it, increases the curiosity, and allows us to deal with it a little bit easier, a little bit better.
Right. So that makes me think about, you know, if you're willing to say, well, I'm feeling sad today, can you step back as you're kind of observing and saying, well, where do you feel the sadness?
Right.
Right. Where do you feel it? So if we can't emotionally get to it, we carry it somewhere in our body. There's that heaviness under your sternum or somewhere. But just being curious, saying, well, where am I feeling it? And do I know anything about that? Yeah, that's the feeling I keep getting every time I think about mom. Or, you know, I think about missing my wedding. I had a beautiful 4-person, but I had planned a 400-person wedding. Or that type of thing. So I like that. What's one thing that we could encourage everybody? I like the prior week where you said, you know, stop. I think that can come into play here, that if I stop, think, take a breath, observe, but it feels like I want to be respectful to the sadness or the feeling that's shown up, right, to the feeling. So I want to be respectful to it, and I also just want to throw out there, if you're in the middle of the grocery store and all of a sudden you flash back to the moment you held your 6-month-old baby on a cold January morning, And you know that new baby smell they still have at 6 months? And it's just a glorious feeling. That's called savoring. So I would go ahead and give into that in the canned aisle at the grocery store too.
Absolutely.
Don't push that one away. Take the time with that one as well. So
right.
We can do both by kind of saying, wow, hey, that's neat that that showed up right now. Maybe it's a can of baby food you saw that did it, but sink right into it and savor it. Store up that feeling again.
Right.
Is just as important, I think, when that pops as just saying, wow, I'm feeling really sad right now. And
absolutely.
I just,
that's both ways.
Just in this moment, I'm just going to say in my head, I accept where I am right now. And I don't have to explain it, don't have to defend it, don't need to judge it. It happened, and that's what I feel right now.
So it might be a good week then to take something that we've learned over the past few weeks and just practice it a little bit more.
Yeah, yeah. So that's a great idea, using the stop tool, our box breath, and realizing that if I do either one of those, I can then calmly go into being the observer saying, what do I know about this? And can I just be a little bit more compassionate about it?
There we go. Exactly.
Awesome. All right. I think this is a great thing to bring up as we're heading into spring, and it feels hopeful that a lot of people might be experiencing those. Why couldn't I have been today that my graduation as I would have, you know, and just let them live through that, accept it, and process forward. So thank you very much, Kathy.
Oh, thank you, Tim. Have a good week.
You too.